gentlemen in Bible study this evening. Thanks for taking the time to come out and study with us here this evening. Thank you guys for tuning in on Facebook with us. We're always glad to have you and those who pull it up on YouTube. Thank you for doing that. I pray you're able to keep up with everything. I'm sure you are. We're going to start this evening with Brother John Aker. John brought his guitar. We're just going to lay and worship the Lord. Let's worship with him. Brother John.
Good job, Brother John. Go ahead, buddy. Yeah, do you know? Got to keep you in practice, John.
Thank you.
job, Brother John. I tell you, give God a praise for that fellow again. He is awesome. When I first started coming to this church, the first time I heard Brother John sing, I told Linda, I said, that guy sounds like George Jones. You call him Vern Dawson. Yeah. Well, I think he outdoes both of them, John does. Bless his heart. He is so precious. He's gonna have so many friends up there, you won't be able to carry him, John. Get help. All the people he's ministered to. Well, we're in chapter 8 tonight, week number 42, and we're going to look at the first 6 verses in chapter 8. We're going to open the 7th seal tonight. Sure, Charles. Absolutely, buddy.
Just one verse I'll read in the last verse in chapter 6.
Yes, sir.
That's the anger of the Lamb.
Yes.
For the great day of his wrath is come. And who shall be able to stand? The great day of his wrath is come. That means
prayer. It's coming. It's coming in the great tribulation. That's what's coming. Yes. Yeah, who's going to be able to stand? Only those who are in Christ. Only those who are in Christ will be able to stand during this tribulation time. So anyway, we're going to look at verses 1 through 6 this evening. Then we'll go back and we'll discuss them together. Chapter 8, starting with verse 1. When he opened the 7th seal, John writes, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. And I saw the 7 angels who stand before God, and to them were given 7 trumpets. Then another angel, having a golden censer, came and stood at the altar. He was given much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense, with the prayers of the saints, ascended before God from the angel's hand. Then the angel took the censer, filled it with fire from the altar, and threw it to the earth. And there were voices, noises, thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake. So the 7 angels who had the 7 trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Whew, let's get ready to get rough, then. Heading into the tribulation wrath. Father, we come tonight in the name of the Lord Jesus. We come thanking you for all these who have gathered here this evening in your house. And Lord, those who are tuning in over the air. And we just ask now, Holy Spirit, as you put these words in John's heart, that he might be able to put them on parchment. I pray that you open them up unto us, that we may understand that we are in a time of grace, but that time is coming to a close, and looks like it might be quickly, but help us, Lord, just to see that which you want us to see tonight about the great tribulation, so that we will not be in fear, but so that we will have this information that we might share with others, so that as Brother Charles read from your word, that we might be able to stand when that day comes for all of us who are born again in Christ. And we'll give you the thanks and the praise and the glory. In your wonderful name we pray. Thank you, Jesus. And all the saints would say, we love you, Lord.
Love you, Lord. Love you, Lord.
Amen and amen. I'm going to try to raise this thing up just a little bit. And if any of you know how clumsy I am, anything may happen when I start doing this. I think we got it. I don't know if I need stronger glasses or a taller speaker stand. One of the two is going to have to take place. Well, we're looking at the opening of the 7th seal. And, of course, we are coming from what I call the parenthetical chapter, or the chapter that was in parentheses, the last part there of chapter 7, when we talked about those who were being sealed. It's as though that we got that information, and now we're going right to the seventh seal. Here's something you'll note in this book as we go through it. John follows that same pattern all the way through the rest of this book. You'll have six things that happen, and then you'll have an informational section as to what's getting ready to happen or what has happened, and then another event will take place. So that's where we were. We were at the part that he told us about those being sealed. We saw the great multitude that was saved, or that will be saved, out of the great tribulation. We are talking here tonight from here through on out, ever since chapter 4, actually. We're talking about future events. This is the future. We are not in the tribulation yet. I know it may seem that way, depending on where you are in the world, but what we're reading here is for the future. Now, there are things that we will learn. There are things that we'll be able to see, that we may be able to pull out of the scriptures that may help us in our everyday life. But these things that we're going to read about, they are futuristic. And here's the good news. If you are a born-again Christian, if you are in Christ, you're not going to have to endure this. This is information for you that you may share with those who are not Christians, so that you can tell them, listen, you don't want to be here when all this takes place. So that's where we're at in this book. This is the final seal on the scroll, right? Because when Jesus took it out of the hand of him who sits on the throne, they were having seals. Seven seals. Six of them were opened, then we had a parenthetical chapter, and then we picked it up on the seventh seal. Now, the information contained in this portion of the scroll will cover from here all the way through chapter 11. And keep in mind now that we're being told what lies ahead for the people who are on earth, who are on the earth, following the rapture of the church. This is where we're headed. These seals and the way they're open, with things that happened, we know that a quarter population of the earth was killed, and we saw that happen in 6, and then in 7, we saw the sealing of the 144,000 Michael evangelists, and then we saw the great multitude that would be saved because of their preaching. We were told all that. Now we're going into the seventh seal, and we're going to begin to see now the things that are going to happen upon the earth during these 7 years. And it will be divided into groups of 7, but it's not going to be like there's 21 different things. It's just the fact that we're going to see it from the different angles of which it is coming up on the earth during those 7 years. That's why I told you to begin with. This book is not chronological. If it was in order, as far as this happens and this happens, it would take 21 years for everything to happen that happens, but it's not. So we're giving it a nutshell exactly what's going to happen in 7 years. All right, let's look at verses 1 through 3 to begin with. I'll read it again. When he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. I saw the 7 angels who stand before God, and to them were given 7 trumpets. Then another angel number 8, having a golden censer, came and stood at the altar. He was given much incense, so that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. 7 angels and 7 trumpets. Now, if you're like me, and we're Gentiles, and we're not into Judaism, we just take that and be 7 angels and 7 trumpets. But the teaching in Judaism, Orthodox Judaism, is, and pulled up on the internet, it's great reading, it's very interesting, is they believe that there were 7 archangels, one for each day of the week, and each of those archangels offer up prayer for the people each day, one for Monday, one for Tuesday, one. The only two I recognized in their list was, guess who? Who are the two archangels we
Gabriel.
Yeah, Michael and Gabriel. They're one of the seven. They're in the list. But that's how Judaism looks at that. Remember, I told you that this revelation was aimed at who? The Jews. So these things that we see put in place, these things that we see happening, are going to point to traditions and things and customs and things that primarily the Jews had or they were doing. Because while Christ was on earth, he was drawing the attention away from the law and away from the tabernacle and away from the sanctuary. He was drawing attention into himself. And he hasn't stopped doing that. So when he went back and he took the church out, comes back and gets the church and takes us out, we know that during that first part of that 7 years, that the Jews are going to start the sacrificial system with the temple and the tabernacle, and all that's going to start again. Well, once again, just as God had shown through Christ that that's no longer the way it is, he's going to do the same thing in regards to the tribulation. Here's one good thing about God. There's a million good things about him. But here's one good thing about him. He never changes his mind. And he never changes. He's the same today, yesterday, and forever. He doesn't have a plan B. He doesn't have a plan B. His plan has always been the same. Regardless of how it may be played out, or regardless of how it may be shown, it's always the same. If the Bible were a screenplay, and this was the scripture, or this was the script to a movie, you would see that after about the first two or three acts, you'd say, well, this is pretty much the same thing. It pretty much is. Paul wrapped it up by simply saying, Christ come to save sinners, among whom I'm the chief. That's the message of this book. And how we got to where we are is what it tells us. So anyway, we see that these angels who were standing in the presence and now have the trumpets, but before God, are offering up, they're getting ready to get these trumpets, and the other angel comes and he's got his censer. He's getting ready to offer up the incense. What about the silence? Well, this silence is great writers, likely related to the incense. This silence is likely related to the incense. Now, as with commentators and scholars, you can find 1,000 different opinions on what this silence is. But I believe it is related to the incense because it was in the Old Testament. Well, even up in some of the New Testament, it was Jewish custom that when the priest entered the sanctuary to offer up the incense, you know how often he did that for each day? Morning and evening. He went once in the morning to trim the lamps, put them out because it was daytime. He trimmed the lamps in the morning, but he burned incense when he went in. In the evening, he had to go in and light the lamps, and he burned the incense when he went in. And then once a year, he would go in to burn the incense on the Day of Atonement. So the burning of the incense is intercessory in the aspect of what the priest does. So when he entered the sanctuary, regular day, not just once a year, to offer up the incense, tradition says, Jewish tradition, says that the people would stand outside and watch him go in, and they would pray, but they would pray silently. It would be a silent prayer. It wouldn't be overwhelming noise that they were listening. You remember part of the priestly garment, on the bottom of the garment, they had what on the bottom? What is it, Mary?
Bells.
Bells. They had little golden bells. Now, I had heard that those bells were on there so that they would know that when the priest went in to the sanctuary, that God was accepting of him, and they could hear the bells tinkle, and they knew that he was still alive. And I also heard that they would tie a rope around the ankle of the priesthood, so if he died, they could pull it out. When I was in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, several years ago, they have a full-size tabernacle up there. If you ever get a chance to go to Lancaster, go downtown, and the Amish have a full-size tabernacle to scale, to biblical scale, the courtyard, the sanctuary, and they have a little theater set up inside there that you can observe in the holiest of holies. They actually have a robot that plays that Aaron is the priest. And he comes in and he goes through the rituals. It's robotic, but it is excellent to watch that. So this lady who explains everything about the tabernacle, when it was over, I asked her about that, and she laughed. She said, "Honey, that's an old wives' tale." She said, "Number one, if that priest is not right with God, he's not going to make it through the courtyard. He'll die between the altar and the sanctuary because nothing unholy can be in the presence of God." So, no, that is not true. They don't tie a rope on his foot, and they don't, but they do have the bells on that. And the bells on that indicate that he is going into the sanctuary and he is in there to minister, and that's why they're quiet, but because it's a reverence of the fact that the priest is in there offering up intercessory prayers, their prayers that they're praying outside. So there's silence when they do that. Now listen, I wouldn't believe it if it wasn't scriptural.
Turn Brother Mike Ruth and I saw that up there too.
That's nice, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Turn to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. And look at verse 10. Who do you say? Use the Luke chapter 1 and verse 10. You see a hand. Marie, read that for us. Luke 1 and verse 10. Listen.
"And the whole multitude of the people was praying outside at the hour of incense."
That's where it comes from. So it makes sense to me that that's why there was a half an hour of silence, because this angel who was as the high priest, he's not the high priest. We know who the high priest of heaven is, don't we? Yeah. But this angel was carrying through the same thing that the high priest did. So I believe that that's where the silence comes into play. Now we'll talk a little bit more about this altar of incense. Turn to Exodus in chapter 30. Exodus chapter 30. And we're talking about this altar. This angel has got this incense out. In Exodus chapter 30, I'm going to read these 10 verses. You can follow along. Moses wrote, "You shall make an altar to burn incense on. You shall make it of acacia wood. A cubit shall be its length, and a cubit its width, and it shall be square. And 2 cubits shall be its height. Its horns shall be of one piece with it. And you shall overlay its top, its sides all around, and its horns with pure gold. And you shall make for it a molding of gold all around it. Two gold rings you shall make for it under the molding on both its sides. You shall place them on its two sides, and they will be holders for the poles with which to bear it. You shall make the poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. And you shall put it, listen, you shall put it before the veil, that is, before the ark of the testimony, before the mercy seat that is over the testimony, for I will be with you. Aaron shall burn on it sweet incense every morning when he tends the lamps. He shall burn incense on it. And when Aaron lights the lamps at twilight, he shall burn incense on it, a perpetual incense before the Lord throughout your generations. You shall not offer strange incense on it, or a burnt offering, or a grain offering, nor shall you pour a drink offering on it. And Aaron shall make atonement upon its horns once a year with the blood of the sin offering of atonement. And once a year he shall make atonement upon it throughout your generations. It is most holy to the Lord.
Where were you reading from?
Exodus chapter 30. Exodus chapter 30. I might have said it for me. I'm a little dyslexic. It might have said it for me. Exodus chapter 30.
No, you said 30.
Did I say 30? Yeah. Thank you. And it's the first 10 verses there. That's the altar of incense. And it is no doubt that we could say it's the same picture. It's the same scenario, right? Pretty much. Well, how do we know that? Well, that's a good question. Turn to Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. No holler bingo. Hebrews chapter 8, verses 3 through 5. Hebrews chapter 8. Now listen to what this says. Now remember what we just read in Exodus chapter 30. Remember that. Now listen to this. 8 and 3. For every high priest is appointed to offer both gifts and sacrifices. Therefore it is necessary that this one, that oath should be capitalized, because he's talking about Jesus. That this one also has something to offer. Look at number 4. For if he were on earth, he would not be a priest, since there are priests who offer the gifts according to the law. Watch this. Who serve the copy and shadow of the heavenly things, as Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle. For he said, God said, see that you make all things according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. A shadow of the things which are in heaven. Well, what does that mean?
Example.
James. What we saw unfolding in the Old Testament happening in heaven during the Great Tribulation. Now what that does is tie God back to his original covenant that he had made with the Israelite people. That's why I preach to you all the time, there is no such thing as replacement theology. Don't fall for that. Don't buy that. Don't listen when they say that the church has replaced Israel. It's a lie. They have not. We have been grafted in to the people of God by way of Christ. But we have certainly not all become one big happy group. he still has them as his original covenant people. And you may not like that, but too bad, that's who they are. And we have to understand that. So what John sees in heaven unfolding is the same thing that Moses saw when he built the tabernacle. You put that together. For those in the first century who were suffering, this was a comfort to them to know that they could simply say, this is the same God. This is the same God. If he saved them then, why wouldn't he save them now? See? So that's why I say, God doesn't have a plan B. It's always been the plan. And the plan has always been to draw attention unto him, to have worship, and for souls to be saved. That's why we're here. That's why he made us. That's why he created us. Because he wanted us to be with him in eternity, that we might worship him forever and ever. And I don't know about you, but I'm willing to do that. Rather than go to hell and burn forever and ever and ever.
Yeah.
If you have a problem with worshiping God forever and ever, whoo, you probably won't have to. I think I would change my attitude if I were here. But the answer in your notes there is Hebrews chapter 8, verses 3 through 5. It is a shadow of the heavenly things. But now pay attention. This angel is not Christ. This angel is not Christ. There are those who teach that it is. And they teach that because Christ is our intercessor. But we're on earth, guys. When we leave here, he's not going to be our intercessor there. Guess who we're going to see face to face? Him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Why do we know that this angel is not Christ? Why do we know that? It's just given to us right here. Why do we know it's not Christ? Because he is the Lamb that's opening the seals. He's the Lamb. And he's the one opening the seals. He didn't lay the scroll down and walk around and pick up a censer and walk to the altar. That sounds facetious, doesn't it? That sounds kind of smart out. But for those who teach that, that's what they would have to believe. They would have to believe he laid the scroll down and went to our helmet in one hand and picked up the censer in the other and went over to the altar. No, it's not Christ. I don't really get that. It's an angel who is offering up incense with the prayers of the saints. Anybody know what a censer is? C-E-N-S-E-R.
Censer.
It's a pot. Don't that blow your mind? Have you seen the Catholic Church when the bishops come down and the cardinals and come in to start the mass and get ready to open and they got this big, looks like a giant lantern on a chain and that thing is swinging back and forth and you think it's smoke coming out of it? You know what that is coming out of it?
Incense.
That's a censer. I don't know that the biblical censers look like that. Maybe they did. But a censer is something that holds hot coals. So the priest of Aaron was able to hold the hot coals in the censer. And then he takes the incense. He puts the censer on the golden altar. And he puts the incense on it. And the smoke goes up. Off of the altar. Off the incense, off the hot coals, that goes up. That's what the censer is. And as looking at what we see in modern times, I don't know if it had a lid on it. I don't know. All I know is something you can carry hot coals in. That's what we know for sure, because that's what they used it for. Now look at verse 4. Verse 4 says, and the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hand. Yeah? Ascended before God. Get this picture. God is still high and lifted up. When you talk about being in the midst of the throne and there at the throne, he's not sitting here where we are. He's above where they are. The throne is up. The throne's above everything. He's God. He's up on this throne. So when the smoke rises, it ascends to him. I mean, he's up. He's here. He's in sight. John saw him who sits on the throne with the Lamb.
The more incense you put on there, the more smoke you got.
The more smoke you got, Charles. Go back and find out the recipe to make that incense. You'll find that they made it a pound at a time. They had some measurements of what they had to make it out of, and it was a special incense. It wasn't everyday incense that the common people could use. God, go back through Exodus, and you'll find that it has a specific recipe of what it's to be made out of, because we just read in Exodus, it is holy. It's a most holy thing unto God.
Not anybody could make it.
That's exactly right, Charles. It had to be by that recipe, by those who God had shown to do that. So it's a shadow. The incense is a shadow, an example, as James said. And the incense gives what of our prayers ascending to God? We just said, when you put the incense on the fire, on hot coals, it burns, and the smoke does what? That is a...
I would think it gives people hope.
It's a visual sign. It's a visual sign of what's happening with our prayers. We can't see our prayers ascend, can we? We know they do. Well, how do we know they do? Because that's what the incense does. When you put the incense on the hot coals and the fire, the smoke ascends with the prayers of the saints. David, no doubt, in Psalm, I think it's either 141 or maybe Psalm 1, David likens his prayers to the incense. The people knew that. We get hung up on the things and not what the things represent. We get hung up on the instruments, and we miss the worship that comes off of that instrument. We miss the song. We miss the worship that comes from it. We see the guitar. God hears the worship music that comes from that. So we see the incense going, no. The people knew that's the prayers ascending unto God. They knew that's what that represented. They knew their prayers were being answered. It was a visual sign. So John sees that prayer does reach the throne room. Prayer does get to where it goes. Well, how do you know that? Well, I'm glad you asked. Look at Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 16. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 16. Brother James, find that and read it for us. Hebrews chapter 4.
Verse 16.
And verse 16.
Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Let us come boldly to the throne of grace. How do you and I That's why Paul said we pray in the Spirit. We pray with the Spirit. But we are there through prayer. That's how we make our petitions known to God. That's how we come to Him. The disciples said, Jesus, teach us how to pray. I don't blame him. He was a good prayer. He prayed things happen. Right? I mean, you're following this guy, and he says, you're all the way here. He goes off in the wilderness all night at some points. He goes and prays, and he comes back, and things change, and things are happening. And the disciples said, teach us how to pray. He said, okay. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. He told who he is, and he told who he was. He is in heaven, he is our Father, and he is hallowed. That's how it starts. That's what prayer is. We go before his presence with that prayer. That incense was the indication of that. I know that's a lot of talk to get that point across, but that'll help you when you pray. Next, when you go to pray tonight, you'll picture that incense smoke going out. You will. I am planting that seed in there. You'll see that. What we're seeing here, what's happening here at this altar in this verse, in these three verses of verse 4, what we're seeing, this is the prayers of the saints being answered. We're getting ready to see the prayers of the saints being answered. If you'll flip back over to Revelation chapter 6, that's just a page over. If you look at chapter 6 and verse 10, you'll see the prayers of these saints. Revelation 6 and 10. And they, those who were under the altar, and they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth. How long was it? About 10 paragraphs. Because now it's getting ready to happen in chapter 8. He is getting ready to avenge. He is getting ready to judge and avenge those who are on the earth who were anti-Christ, who are anti-Christians. That's what we're seeing happen with the prayers of the saints. Now, verse 5 and 6. Then the angel took the censer. He filled it with fire from the altar, threw it to the earth, and there were voices, thunderings, lightnings, and an earthquake. So the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. He took his censer that holds fire. He filled it with fire from the altar. Which altar?
Altar of incense. No.
There's no fire on the altar of incense. Fire is in the censer. The censer is set onto the altar, it says. That sounds like a trick question. The fire came from the altar of burnt offering. Why? We ain't seen that. Turn to Leviticus chapter 6. Leviticus chapter 6 and verse 12. Leviticus chapter 6 and verse 12. We are talking about the fire of the burnt offering. Leviticus chapter 6. Chapter 12, because I'm dyslexic. Leviticus chapter 6 and verse 12. shall not be put out, and the priest shall burn wood upon it every morning and lay the burnt offering in order on it. And he shall burn on it the fat of the peace offering. So the fire, which is on the burnt offering, is where they get the fire to put in their censers. The fire on the altar shall be kept burning on it. That was the law of the burnt offering. And that's where the fire came from, that went into the censer that was carried into. See the connection? See the connection of the sacrifice of the burnt offering, which was the sacrifice. It tells there the ashes are taken outside, the blood is applied on the altar, sprinkled, and that fire in that censer, which comes from this burning altar. Do you remember Aaron's sons that died because they had that holy fire?
Strange
fire from the Lord. They was going to burn the incense, but God didn't tell them to do it. And they got, see, all the people carried a censer. You go back and find out when Korah, remember the rebellion of Korah and the 250 that followed them? Moses told them, he said, go get your censers. So all of them had one. People had one. But see, it was a special incense, like Charles said. They all got their censers. He said, stand before the tent of meeting. Remember what happened to them, guys? The earth opened up and swallowed all of them and closed back over top of them.
And then closed back up.
Closed back up. This stuff is holy. This is not just ritualistic purism or things that they're going through just to be religious. This is something God has set in place. Fire does what? Purges. Purges. John the Baptist said, I baptize you with water, but he shall baptize you with fire and the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost and fire. Because the Holy Ghost will purge you. When he comes into your heart, he cleans the house. The Holy God's not going to live in an unclean temple. He's going to purge it. He's going to cleanse it. All this is happening there in heaven. The Jews understood what was going on. They knew that was taking place. This is the heavenly sanctuary. Now, there are no sacrifices on that altar in heaven, even though it's set up as a carbon copy of the tabernacle which is on earth, or we could say the tabernacle on earth was a carbon copy of the one that's in heaven. But there's no sacrifices taking place on that altar. Why? Amen. Because Jesus is the final sacrifice. There's no need for any more. So what were they doing this 3.5 years during the tribulation? They were sacrificing. Yeah. They was carrying the incense into it. They were going through these motions. They were doing that. And God says, now I'm going to do it for real. And he takes us, and they know what's going on. So the angel goes in, and he takes those prayers in there. And God has every intention of answering. And then look what he did there. I lost my place. Look what he did there in verse number 6. Get back over here. Good old 10. And he said he took the fire from that, filled the fire from the altar, threw that thing to the earth. And then there were voices and thunderings, lightnings. The King James says voices. I like that. It is voices. I looked that word up and I tracked it down through the Greek. Noise is one word for it. But it's voices. And the reason I know it's voices, because it's the same thing we find in Revelation chapter 4 and verse 5. And there it's translated as voices. And it should be voices in the New King James here. But it's the same thing. It is the voices. He threw that thing to the earth. That's a drastic move. Because, see, censers were used for intercession. censers were God designed and he gave it to them, that it would be for intercession. It's the fact that priests take these censers and they intercede for the people. You'll find anywhere in the Old Testament they took the censer and threw the fire on people. You won't find that in there. But remember, things have changed. Christ has come. Christ has died. Christ has been resurrected. Christ has ascended. Now he's in heaven executing this scroll, this plan of eternity, this blueprint that's going to bring the consummation of all things together. So it's no difference that things have changed. Censers were for intercession, but now they incite destruction. Now it incites destruction. That which was once symbolic to intercede for people has now become the object to start the wrath of God of all people. It's just like an angry thing. Well, here's the prayer of the saints, which says, avenge those who have. Says, okay, I will. And that angel says, well, let's get it started. He fires that thing. And this is symbolic now. I don't see that there'd be an actual censer coming out of the clouds and whopping people. But then remember, these things are given to John. He's able to see, so he's able to write it down. So he sees what's taking place. We're going to see what happens, what the result of throwing this censer to the earth is going to be. We're getting ready to see what that result is going to be. Because he says here in chapter 6, as soon as that happened, so, I like the way John writes. So, imagine him seeing it, and he sees all that's happening, and you know how it is. I mean, if you were envisioning that, and here stands these seven angels, and they all got seven trumpets, and the eighth one is offered up the incense, and then he turns around and throws his censer towards the earth, and then you hear the voices and the thunderings and the lightning. What do we know is coming when we hear thunder and lightning? Storm. There's a storm on the way, isn't there? And he sees all this power that's taking place in incense in verse 6. So the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. What's that mean? Don't get overly analytical here. The standard hold the trumpet, what do they do? They prepared themselves to sound. That was their cue. That was their cue that this thing is getting ready to happen. And when that eighth angel fired that thing, they came to attention probably and they put their trumpets up because they know what's coming. They know what's going to happen next. No, it's not with Gabriel. When we get to the final trumpet, we're going to talk about that in the trumpets because I've seen it several times that the final trumpet is a trumpet that calls the rapture. No, it's not. It does fit the plan. We'll see that. We'll see how all that comes into play. But these seven trumpets, which are getting ready to sound, they're going to introduce the wrath of God, which comes up on the earth. And we'll start with that next week. In fact, next week we'll look at verses 7-9, and we'll cover the first and the second trumpet in verses 7-9. I think we can get both of them in next week. So if you want to go and read through that whole chapter, that's fine. That's good. You can do that. But we're going to see how that plays out with the sounding of the trumpets. Questions or comments? on any of them.
Are there going to be any more restrictions on the churches and anything?
I didn't find any more restrictions as far as the mask goes. I know the governor has mandated that, and I searched and searched and searched. I don't find anything about councils of worship. What I found was public buildings. And in a public building, see, the church is not really a public building. A public building is where people have to go to do public business. Now, like a Walmart is not a public building. Walmart's a store. And restaurants are a public building. But the DMV is a public building. The post office is a public building. They're buildings where you have to go into, and they're state governed. Actually, in reality, the church is a private building. But we can say who comes in and who don't if we want to. Yeah, George?
Pastor Mike, I listened to what he said yesterday.
Yeah.
And he said that they were working to pass legislation regarding the mask.
Yeah.
That as the restaurants require you to wear shirts and shoes, that they would, the mask wearing would be like that.
Right, for the restaurants.
Yeah,
I read that.
Public places like that.
I read that. That's why I say the restaurants, the restaurants, the stores, I found nothing about houses of worship. The only thing that has to do with any grouping at all is that if you're in a group where you cannot stay 6 feet apart and you're going to be there longer than 10 minutes, I've researched it all. There was nothing. The only thing about the houses of worship traces all the way back to May under phase one, when they mandated for houses of worship in their night to have mass. But right now, it's not for us. I didn't see anything there that said that. If you've seen our signs on the doors, and I'm sure that you have, our signs say that masks are recommended, that they're not mandatory. If you wear a mask, that is absolutely fine. There was no problem at all. But that's why we have you guys scattered out. That's why we have the pews marked. That's why we're doing what we're doing to maintain that social distancing of the 6 feet so that we're not jammed into that close proximity, that we don't have to be within 6 feet of each other so that we have to wear the mask. So I don't see anything that had changed this way. Now listen, they want to imply that to churches. That's their agenda. Like it or not, that's the agenda to be applied. But we use common sense. Now if we were in a small area and we didn't have room like we had to spread out and we had to be confined, yeah, we should all wear a mask, be in that close proximity to where we don't have room to spread out. But with us having the room and the ability to do that, we're going to do business as usual. We still have the mask available for anybody that wants to wear one. They can get one when they come in. But if they don't, then they just need to maintain the social distancing. That's where we're at on it. If that changes, I'll let everybody know. But I just don't see legislating the mass of worship. I don't see that happening. If it does, it will surprise me. But I just don't see it legislating houses of worship because we are separate from the state. They don't like to know that, but we are. We are separate from the state. They don't govern us. They can threaten us. Well, we're going to take you 501c. Well, go ahead. Don't matter to me. It's not going to change the church. The church is the church. It's not going to change the church. The church is not building anyway. The church is the people, right? So I don't see legislation for houses of worship coming onto the document. The legislation, that's the law part. Now, the mandated order, yeah, but that's not law. I think it stems back to where when this started, when the first mask order came out, I think it was May the 28th or 29th, then I researched that, and it said on there, in his statement he posted on the website. You go to the Governor of Virginia website, and I tell you, it is not updated. You can't find just bits and pieces of paragraphs. It's like they don't want to tell you nothing. Everything you learn is from the northern news channels. You can't get it straight from the horse's mouth. You can't look at the original document. You just have to take bits and pieces. But when this started back in May, and it said the Virginia Department of Health would be, you know, they would be instituting this, they would be this, and they would be doing it, I contacted the Virginia Department of Health. I chatted with the Virginia Department of Health, and here's what they told me. They said, absolutely not. We cannot force something that's not law. It has to be a law before we can do anything. We can recommend, and you may be mandated, but if it's not law, we can't enforce a mandate. It has to be a law. So I think that's where the legislation is headed, is so there will be a law that it can be enforced. But I still don't see that happening in the houses of worship. I'll be really surprised if it goes that far. And I've been surprised before, but we'll see. We'll see.
Pastor, could you give us the answer to that last?
I will. I just asked, which one is it there?
The voice is thundering.
The voice is in the thunder. It goes back to chapter 4 and verse 5.
Thank you.
Revelation 4 and verse 5. Because in 4 and 5 it says, in chapter 4 and verse 5 of Revelation says, and from the throne proceeded lightnings, thunderings, and voices. So those are the same ones that John in chapter 4, these are the same ones he heard in this chapter. Anybody else? All right. I'll do like Ken Pope used to do. Pastor Pope used to say, all hearts and minds, please. I have a lot of time. Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you for these together. We thank you for those who have tuned in. Thank you for those who will pick it up maybe on YouTube later. And we just ask our Father, as we go from this place, we take that which you teach us and that which we learn, that we will go from here and share that with others. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for showing us these things in our spirits, that we might be better disciples and we might be better witnesses and better evangelists as we witness for you and win people to Christ, that the kingdom may be built. We don't want to see anybody enter into this tribulation time. And we don't know when it will be. But Lord, things are happening pretty quick around us. And we see those things happening. So we have an opportunity right now, to build upon that and to witness for you. Go with these that are here and those who are watching. Be with them, protect them, keep